हेलो माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, हेलो माय डियर लिसनर्स, हाउ आर यू ऑल? आई होप यू आर डूइंग योर बेस्ट इन दिस सिचुएशन एंड विद दिस गुड विश लेट्स स्टार्ट द नेक्स्ट स्टोरी फ्रॉम बंगाल फेरी टेल्स इन आवर दिस सेगमेंट विच इज़ नोन एज फेरी टेल्स ऑफ बंगाल. नाउ दिस बुक वॉज रिटन बाय फ्रांसिस ब्रैडली बर्ड इन द ईयर 1920 एंड ऑल द इलस्ट्रेशंस ऑफ दिस बुक was done by Avanindranath Thakur. I am taking this book from Bengal fairy tales. This book I am taking from wiki source. So let's proceed. This book was published by in London John Lane the Bodley Head and in New York John Lane Company. So till now what we came to know that it has at least three parts. It has three parts, and in the first part the stories were told by Bhabhughure. Bhabhughure means Bhabo means world, who travels throughout the world, so the traveler. Now we are going to start the third story, which is Buddhivanto the boy weaver. The first word is Buddhivanto. Buddhi means wisdom and Banto means it is like who has it, that means wise. So today is the story Buddhivanto the boy weaver. In a certain village in rural Bengal there lived a young weaver, Buddhivanto by name. He had a mother to whom he was very obedient. The power of judging for himself was not to be found in him, and he did everything his mother told him to do. He was married, but his wife was too young to leave her father's house and live in her husband's. It was necessary, however, that husband and wife should sometimes meet, and so one day our hero's mother wished him to visit his better half. But how the weak and foolish boy would behave in society was a source of anxiety to his mother. She at length thought that it would be best to send her son with a friend as his protector and guide. After giving him some good advice, and accordingly, on the most auspicious day named by the village astrologer, Buddhi left home with his friend and the parting instructions of his mother, which were to bow deeply to any grave-looking lady of his father-in-law's house, for there were several ladies there who were worthy of his respect, to put as much food into his mouth as could be taken up with only five fingers, that is, to eat as little food as possible, for to appear greedy in one's father-in-law's house was an excusable indecency, and to take the shortest and the most direct path when returning home alone, for his friend might not find it convenient to wait during the whole time he might be detained by his mother-in-law. With these words of advice stored in his mind and his friend Jaggu accompanying him, he reached his destination and was at once taken into an inner apartment where he beheld, though at a distance, his veiled wife, who appeared anxious to avoid him according to the immemorial custom of her country that no girl wife should show her face to her lord before marriage. Running towards her, he bowed low to her, touching her feet with his forehead. This made everyone in the house titter, but unconscious of his stupidity, he went in, squaring his chest and bearing himself proudly. Sometimes afterwards, a dish containing fruits and sweets was laid before him, and he could, without difficulty, put each of this into his mouth, agreeably to his mother's advice. But when the noonday meal was served, being naturally voracious, he invoked the most fearful curses on his mother's head on account of the restraint her commands enjoined upon him. The day passed without anything noteworthy happening, and at night when the last meal was served, he was in the same predicament as at dinner, or even in a greater, for the dish before him was then khichuri, a mixture of boiled rice and pulse seasoned with ghee and spices. The greater portion of the food was liquid, and poor Buddhi was at a loss to discover how to quit the cravings of hunger. But his mother's command was his law, and with great regret he was forced to leave most of the dish uneaten. Finally, the whole house retired for the night. Buddhi, of course, was in the same room with his wife, and his friend was in the room in the outer apartments. The wife, too young to enter into a long conversation with him, soon fell asleep, but the burning of his empty stomach kept him awake, and on tiptoe he crept out into the room occupied only by his friend. He roused him and with tears informed him of his distress. Together he and his friend began searching about the room, with the result that they found a trap door leading into a room below. Buddhi bent his head to try and see if there was any food there, and to his delight he saw a hari full of molasses. He got down through the trapdoor by means of a rope tied round his waist, asking his friend to draw him up when he felt a jerk. Greedily he disposed of the contents of the hari and many handfuls of rice which he found close by. Then, taking the hari still more than half full of molasses on his head and a bundle of rice in his right hand, with the intention of hiding them somewhere and appeasing his hunger on future occasions, he gave the signal to his friend. The latter felt a jerk on the rope and began pulling it up, but the weight of Buddhi and of the things he was carrying was too much for it, and it snapped. Throwing the greedy wretch to the floor, his whole body smeared with molasses mixed with rice, he greatly feared that the house might awake owing to the noise his fall had made. So, in order to scare them away, his brain, dull in useful matters but prolific in mischievous plans, quickly evolved a scheme which was to impersonate a ghost by uttering aloud some indistinct nasal sounds. The plan was carried out, and the inmates of the house, believing that an evil spirit was the sole actor in the scene, could not call up courage enough to enter the storeroom, and one of them ran to the Rojha, the exorcist, and called him in. The Rojha muttered some charms and entered the room, when Buddhi, to make the scene more terrible, rushed towards him with gaping mouth. This was too much for the exorcist, and he fainted. The whole house was in dismay. Women tore their hair in anguish, and the men were paralyzed. At length, Buddhi's wife, aroused from her heavy sleep, left her room and joined them with the report that her husband was not in their room. This increased the uneasiness of her people, for they thought that he had been spirited away, and not only the woman, but the men even cried aloud at the mishap. So what happened next? We will come to know tomorrow. Till then, be happy, be good. Ta-da!